Welcome back, streamers, to another jam-packed episode. Before we jump into today's content, I want to briefly mention that over on the site, whydoesthewilhelmscream.com, as part of Black History Month, we're going to be focusing on a few films by Black filmmakers that premiered at Sundance this year. So up now, I didn't talk to Jason about this. He's fine with it, though. Up now is a piece on the documentary Little Richard, I Am Everything, and coming soon will be write-ups on All Dirt Roads Taste of Salt and Mammy Wata. So keep that in mind if you're so inclined.
Awesome.
Yeah.
I'm looking forward to reading that. Oh. I'm really looking forward to reading the Little Richard piece. I was interested in that. I kind of slept on Sundance this year just on the online piece, and it was a little pricey. What are your thoughts on that? I mean, not the price point, but like the COVIDization of film festivals at this point and opening those up to a wider audience. I don't think it detracts from people going there. And I do think it would be very interesting for film buffs to be able to take in those movies without actually having to travel there and see them. I would really love to see like the bigger ones do this. I would love to see Cannes do this. I would love to see TIFF, the Toronto International do it. I just think it would open it up to a whole new audience and really kind of, I don't know, just kind of cultivate that interest in those movies. You could also then see, obviously you would get online buzz and you could then, I don't know, it just seemed like a groundswell would help for a lot of these films, getting them out into the populace and to be able to be seen. And it's difficult to obviously do that if you have to travel to these places, because obviously the cost is prohibitive, obviously just for travel and just for the event itself. And it can be a daunting thing. Film festivals aren't easy to go to unless you have done it a lot, or if you have press credentials or things like that. But like when I was in college, South by Southwest, and it really wasn't, there was no film portion of South. I was very small, but like you could just buy a wristband and I just bounced around. Nowadays, it is an industry insider thing where you're not going to anything unless you're going to small venues. And even then you're still paying $500-$600. I paid like under $100 for like the week, you know, and then you could just go to any venue you wanted to go to as long as it wasn't sold out or booked.
Maybe you should become a social media influencer.
Then you could
go do whatever you want.
I need to create some sort of AI persona for myself, like a sexy something, you know, like a, I don't know. Like I need a
sexy podcaster. Is that a Halloween costume?
I'm sure it is. I think that's a well-worn. I don't think there's any slots left for sexy podcaster.
No, probably not.
I need some sort of catch, and I'm not sure exactly. I haven't really found my niche yet.
You need a gimmick.
I do.
I think that it is a great idea that these festivals, the ones that are doing it, are making things available online. Like you said, not everybody can get there. It opens up the films to people like us, too, who don't have a cachet built up yet to be like, hey, you know,
right,
I'm so-and-so, give me a press pass. So it gives us a chance to do that, to write about them, to talk about them at the time. But also, yeah, it drums up interest. People know these film festivals, and at least Sundance and the New York Film Festival, Cannes, the Berlinale, I think started today, Venice. I don't think there's any harm that could come from it. And I mean, especially places like Sundance, I mean, one of the things that they do that I respect, even if it can be frustrating if you don't get the ticket you want, is that they limit the number of these things that are sold so that it does still have, if these movies go into theaters later, there's still an audience for it. So they're not saturating that market with people who aren't going to then like see it in wide release or not wide release.
I think the barrier to entry is high enough that you're not going to get hundreds of thousands of people trying to buy these tickets to watch these films, especially when they don't know about them. And I really haven't seen a piracy detriment to these movies either. So these movies aren't showing up online. Mm-hmm. I mean, and so whatever they're doing to protect them that way, that seems to be working.
Yeah.
And so it would be nice to be able to have a block of films, even if you had to specifically get online at particular times to see the movies and to be able to like, and just enjoy them. But
yeah, I mean, and they have windows for these things. So, and once you start it, you only have so many hours to finish it. Mm-hmm. You've got, I think it was the 24th through the 29th of January, I had to watch 4 films. My schedule, not that I'm in demand or like that popular, but my schedule is crowded enough where that was tough.
Right.
But I mean, I also watch Sometimes I Think About Dying, which is Jason's biopic. I'm kidding. But it starred Daisy Ridley. And I forget the woman director's name. It was good as well. But those were 4 films that I specifically like sought out. Right. Those were the ones that I wanted to see. And some of the bigger films like Eileen, they didn't make available online anyway.
Right, right.
And I read that book and I have thoughts on that. But actually, I wrote a review of that book for Slant Magazine back in the day. If you're interested, before you go see the film,
we need like a little.
You can go check out my review.
A plug, a ding or something, some sort of site soundboard thing that goes in there.
Right. Yes. I don't know. I enjoyed all four of the films, but these are the ones that I sought out specifically because of their scale, but also because of the directors, and yeah, they're all three really great.
Yeah, I'm a little subdued today. I'm gonna be honest. Trugoy dying was a bummer.
Plug two.
Yeah.
Trugoy the Dove, plug two.
De La was a seminal group for me growing up. It was one of those first groups. I don't know if we want to dig into this or not, but I mean, obviously I'm the one who derails this podcast more often than not.
Maybe. I don't know. It's okay.
I was right in that kind of sweet spot of that like classic hip hop era. And like, to me, De La was like the first one, the first group that showed me that hip hop could be something different, something nerdier, something more art house and indie. And it was, I don't know, that 3 Feet High and Rising was an album that just played on rotation for me. And I mean, so I was excited. I read about, you know, their struggles with Tommy Boy and getting their stuff out to streaming. And they just
kind of got, coming like March 1st.
Yeah. Yeah. And that'll be cool. That'll be really cool. But yeah,
I'm with you. I mean, obviously I'm a few years younger right. than you.
You can tell it in your voice. Yeah.
And I mean, listeners might look at my beard and be like, well, you are, It's the twinkle in my eye is still there. It's not completely mm-hmm. faded yet. But it was a huge record for me, too. I mean, it came out. What year did that come out?
That I don't know. I would say, if I was to guess, I would say somewhere between 86 and 88.
But I feel like I was around, when I started getting into hip hop, I was around 10, 11. And it was groups like De La Soul. I was a huge Public Enemy fan. Big Daddy Kane, Biz Markie. I mean, so already some of those more artsy, independent, kind of like, I mean, Public Enemy is different, but Biz especially kind of fit in a certain way with De La as well. But I remember seeing the videos, especially Me, Myself, and I on MTV.
Yeah.
And just being like, they're so different than these, than like the D Nice video that I just watched or...
Nice pool.
Very nice pool. Right. Yeah. But again, the same thing. So that was a shock I'm really glad that their stuff is coming back to streaming because I can't find my cassette of De La Soul Is Dead. That was another album that was a kind of a detour from 3 Feet High and Rising, but it was still fantastic and bizarre and zany and just different. And I still listen to 3 Feet High and Rising like all the time because I had it on CD and ripped it to my hard drive so I don't have to deal with the streaming thing.
Right, right, right.
But the other stuff, like you can't.
Yeah, it's hard to find.
You can't get.
And the I equate 3 Feet High to and De La Is Dead to Licensed to Ill and Paul's Boutique.
Sure, sure.
That kind of detour and like just kind of showing you what kind of depth they had. Licensed to Ill was a little bit different because Licensed to Ill was kind of it's a parody is the wrong term.
It's kind of a piss take though.
Right. Yes, it is definitely. And it obviously was co-opted by Brohans to be a straight laced album when it really obviously wasn't. So it's a little bit different, but when Paul's Boutique comes out and everyone's like, what the fuck is this? And if you got it, you got it. And you were like, oh, shit, these guys are fucking next level.
Yeah.
To me, like that to show the range that De La Soul had. And of course, I mean, those groups that came up that really started to, you know, I equate them to Tribe Called Quest a lot, too.
Sure.
I mean, just like, so that was the
group. Well, and they all ran together. I mean, those guys all ran together. And one of the best, like, posse songs ever was Scenario.
Yeah.
I mean, so, but yeah, Leaders of the New School, Jungle Brothers, Busta. I mean,
yes.
All those cats were all around the same and all doing great, great. I don't think De La Soul gets, this is going to sound weird. I don't think they get their due necessarily. No,
because they kind of like they might be giants of like rap, right? I mean, like, I mean, if you only look at them as De La Soul, 3 Feet High and Rising, and you don't, and you haven't gone out to see their other stuff, it's easy to kind of dismiss them as not, not like Mix-a-Lot type novelty, right? It wasn't even Digital Underground type novelty, but to this, and not this, I mean, I know the reason I say Digital Underground is just because when they came out, the stuff that was playing on white radio was were the novelty songs, right? It wasn't
Do What You Like and The Humpty Dance.
Right.
And even though I don't know that Do What You Like so novelty, but
right.
Well, Humpty Dance was the big
one. It's not Buttermilk Biscuits, but I'm saying.
Or My Posse's on Broadway.
Hey, I'm not gonna. I'm not gonna lie. I'm not gonna lie.
SWAT was
banging for me for a long, long time.
I will still out of nowhere just go. My Posse's on Broadway.
Yeah, posse up. So I came up with like UTFO and like Dr. Ice. So I was a little bit. But we were talking about this the other day too. I also was like an 86 when novelty rap was like at its apex and I was listening to the Dragnet soundtrack and City of Crime with fucking Tom Hanks and Dan Aykroyd.
Right.
I'm like, this speaks to me.
It all overlaps.
It's like the scene in The Jerk when Steve Martin hears the fucking jazz band and he finally has rhythm to dance out the house. This is what, this is what the Dragnet rap did for me. But then I got into those groups that were like the Donald Glover joke about, I went to that store and I got myself a hat. It's just that kind of like just very same type of beat.
Also, no one really talks about how Sugar Hill Gang kind of bit off everybody else that was doing stuff at that time and then somehow got famous for it. But
right.
and still like that song has maintained its fame. And I think
because it's so easily digestible and it's also been, it was used in The Wedding Singer and it's just like it goes on forever.
Rapper's Delight.
Right. Yeah.
Sorry.
I from those groups kind of went into DJ Jazzy Jeff and the Fresh Prince, kind of that, the tween bubblegum rap, and then started getting, and then from there on, it was just Too Short and Scarface and Ghetto Boys and NWA. NWA to me, that album and Express Yourself is probably just still my favorite rap song of all time. But like that album was just on rotation. I mean, and I grew up too. I mean, so I was again like about 4 or 5 years older than you. I, remember when I had to go in and like try to pretend like I was 18 because that's when the parental the lyric stuff came out because they didn't want white kids to be buying rap albums.
Thanks,
at that
Tipper
point.
Gore.
Yeah, Tipper Gore. Did you ever listen to Everlast, who was before House of Pain?
Yeah, no, right. Because he did stuff with Ice-T.
Right, that's what I was going to say. So I grew up like when I was like 10 when breakdancing was like, when Breakin' and Breakin' 2 comes out and like all of that, Beat Street. And so that was like, that was kind of the awakening for me. And it's because it was just everywhere, right? It was just, in popular culture for sure. But yeah, Everlast has a song on his first album, and it was not the Whitey Sings. I mean, this is way, way back, even before House of Pain, when he was a straight white rapper.
And not doing like his weird, like acoustic guitar
songs. Right, right, right. But he has a line in there. It's about fuck you, Tipper Gore. There was a definite speak out to call out to Tipper Gore.
Yeah, his pre-House of Pain stuff, I got to through his kind of, he'd have a cameo on an Ice-T song. Mm-hmm. He'd have a cameo on somebody else's song. And that's where
he's got a song called Fuck Everyone. It's a pretty good song. Pretty good. He wasn't one of my favorites, but.
It's a pretty good sentiment.
It's definitely the motto of this podcast.
Yes, it is. Yes,
fuck
it is.
Every one of your movies.
Which is about movies, except we've just like gone. I'm tempted to keep going, but let's talk about some movies.
We do
Jason.
Movies here. We talk about movies.
We talk about a lot of stuff and that's fine. Just under the guise or umbrella of cinema and in the art of film.
I like to call them the hippies of hip hop. Their brand new psychedelic rap has helped this album, 3 feet high and rising, climb to the top of the charts, performing their big hit, Be Myself and I.
It's De La Soul.
Here we go.
Come on.
Mirror, mirror on the wall. Tell me, mirror, what you want? Can it be my De La Soul, or is it just my De La Soul? What I do ain't make-believe. Play, I sit and try. It's just me, myself, and I.
Sing along, y'all.
Oh, it's just me, myself, and I.
So today we're going to be talking about Lost in Translation and Her as kind of a double feature. I'm sure at some point the relationship and the disillusion of said relationship between Sofia Coppola and Spike Jonze will come up, but I have to be honest, I don't care about that relationship at all. And I'm going to push back on this, like, Sofia and Spike break up false narrative that gets put on these two movies kind of by everyone out there in the whatever sphere, because look, they're 10 years apart.
Yeah. And they were a good 6 years after the divorce, I think. I mean,
the divorce was
23. Yeah, so it was right after. It was right before Lost in Translation. I finalized in 2003. Yeah. So maybe not. But no, I think it's a twee look at the whole thing. I mean, I think it's we want to find connections between all different types of films. But if you look at, like, if you take the soundtrack off of any film and you just look at the visuals, you can make and draw parallels to any film. Two films.
And one of the things I really don't like about this comparison, one, okay, yeah, they're 10 years apart. Lost in Translation was 10 years before Her. And we're going to compare composition styles from these two different directors. And no one's going to say, look at Spike biting off of Sofia's style.
Right.
We're just gonna be like, oh, look how they influence each other. No. Like, hang on. You're comparing the elevator shots and going, oh, look how the influence crosses, and it doesn't cross. Like, that really bugs me, I think, about those two, that comparison.
I definitely think it's reductive for sure, especially from a Coppola perspective. I have, and I've said this before, and I'm kind of a dick anyway, but you know, I have a hard time completely lauding and I know the term gets thrown around, that now nepo baby kind of, I think Coppola is a distinguished director in her own right. And I think she's proven that throughout her career. But I have a hard time cheering the underdog aspect of Lost in Translation. Because she comes up with maybe it's something that I'm putting on it.
No, this is interesting though. Yeah.
But I have a hard time championing that, pull yourself up by your bootstraps when you were clearly born on top of the mountain and you had everything. Right. You've got a father who is one of the legends in the industry. You've got a family who is, you know, has basically, you know, fingers in every single pie that you can possibly have them in. You've got Roman Coppola that is available, that writes with Wes Anderson, who, you know, who's also helping you script doctor this. And again, this is not to detract from what Sofia Coppola brought to Lost in Translation at all. I'm just saying, like, when we watched mid-90s, the same thing happened to me too. There too, is like, we talk about this movie like it's this great piece of cinema. It's a good movie, but it's not some sort of like mind-blowing accomplishment in my mind. And maybe again, that's just one of the things that I'm putting on it. But it, to me, like, it's good. I think Lost in Translation is great. It's one of those things I want to tap the brakes a little bit, knowing where it came from and knowing, you know, the tools that she had to play with, because it's not the same as someone who's coming out of nowhere and putting this together and putting together a very similar film.
Well, 100%. I agree with that 100%. I wondered if we were going to touch on the Nepo baby thing. It's such a weird term.
A bizarre term.
Because both of them, in their own ways, are Nepo babies, right? I mean, Spike Jonze, Mr. Spiegel, comes from the Spiegel catalog family. He was not hurting privilege-wise, right? And yes, I know he got his start sort of shooting BMX stuff and shooting skateboarding and then moving into, but he knew, I mean, he had those connections kind of like baked in. And I'm with you on Sofia. There's a lot of stuff that she was able to do that no one else was going to be able to do. Have you watched High Octane?
I have not.
No. Do you know about this? Mm-hmm. Okay. So back in the day, this would have been like 90, I could be wrong, but let's say 94-ish. She and Zoe Cassavetes had a TV show on Comedy Central.
Oh, really?
It was called High Octane. And this would have been, it kind of looks like Winona Ryder's film after Ben Stiller cut it in Reality Bites.
Right,
that
right,
kind yeah. of like, you know, High Octane. But here's like one episode, Sofia and Zoe learn how to drive monster trucks.
Paris Hilton, Nicole Richie.
Exactly. But it's much smarter. And so this is where I'm going to give her some credit. Right? I mean, look, the only reason she was able to have this show is because of who she
right.
who she was.
Because she fucked up Godfather 3 so bad.
Right, right. But like, again, no one else would have been given this opportunity. That's fine. So she and Zoe Cassavetes are learning how to drive a monster truck. They go to monster truck school. At the same time that's happening, cut away, and a fashion photographer who's also their friend is interviewing Karl Lagerfeld at a Paris runway show. So now you're getting this like high and low culture juxtaposition. Cut to that same photographer is working now with Ginny Shimizu. I'm sorry, I just butchered Ginny Shimizu's name, who's a...
We'll just mark it off the list of people who are never coming on the podcast.
Right,
now.
Right. She would probably just... No, I don't think she'd even have the time to look at us. She was, I mean, she's still alive, but not actively working. She was a supermodel who was discovered while she was working as a mechanic. So we see her in her kind of milieu of being a supermodel, and then we see her fixing up a 55 Ford pickup. So again, like this mix of sort of high, low culture. It's kind of interesting, but it's also kind of like really annoying.
Right.
But again, this idea of... No one would have been given a season to just fuck around like that because that's all they were doing was like playing with their friends. Well, okay, you know, fine. I mean, it was sort of like the early mid 90s. That's kind of what was going on, right? But also, I mean, like, sure. You know, she dropped out of school, got an internship at Chanel. Where do you think that came from? And then like had the sort of, you know, means and backing to start her own fashion label called Milkfed, which is Japan only. I mean, so the Nepo baby thing is real. I don't, the film itself, I don't think of it as a kind of like, I don't know. I don't associate anything else with that film other than, okay, it's a Sofia Coppola film.
How do you mean?
I don't put any kind of like, oh, look at this great achievement that she did coming from like, no, because she just did the Virgin Suicides in like, what, 99?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And the same thing there, right? I mean, I never thought like, oh, who is this new, young, like out of nowhere, like filmmaker? So I don't, I in no way sort of associate any kind of mountain climbing aspect with those films. I just think like, of course she has the access and the means, and I'm glad she produced something like this.
Right, right.
So like I said, the nepotism thing is real. I mean, I think about how many people don't have the opportunity, never get the opportunity, no matter how much talent they have. I mean, I have in my notes, like meritocracy does not exist. I think I've written down somewhere, it's like, I don't know that I care that much, even though this does matter, right? Because I don't want to just dismiss it as like, oh, look at these actors and actresses, and we're like nepotism, blah, blah, blah. But it does matter because there are people doing good things that are never going to get that same chance.
I think it's important to note, I don't even think it really informs the work itself.
Right.
I just think it's important to realize when we're evaluating this movie and we're, because to be fair, and I'll just lay, I think this is a great movie. I really, I think.
So do I.
The first 20 minutes, I think, could use a little tweaking. But I think once you start to get into the relationship of Scarlett and Bill Murray, and they really start to perform, I think the quietness of it and how she lets that evolve and the culmination of it all, and just kind of comparing it, the things that she avoids that her does not.
Right.
Is so well done. And again, I talk about this all the time about how, you know, steady of a hand. Yes, I know that she had a whole, you know, we talked again, but I mean, she had the tools, but and The Virgin Suicides, I think, is a great movie as well. I think it's really good, at least. I haven't gone back to look at that one in a hot minute.
I think her first three are really, really, really well, highly accomplished.
But I mean, the steadiness and the confidence, and I know that comes from the script and having the ability to, you know, work with her brother, who's, you know, accomplished scriptwriter and a filmmaker in his own right, really shines through. And this, it really is an amazing piece of work. And so that being said, you know, again, we can acknowledge it and move on. I think it's important to know, because we so often tear down films for you know, inconsistencies or just things that Sophia doesn't do in this movie. But we also don't acknowledge that, you know, that they didn't have the tools that they, you know, that someone like Sofia Coppola does.
Right. Right. And I don't know. And I don't pretend to know how much help she had kind of behind the scenes either.
But one can imagine.
Put cameras here and do that. But she was, right, she grew up around it. So, yeah.
So let's take it from an Elaine May standpoint, right? I mean, like, I know this is our diversion from Elaine May for a week. But the same thing where the Elaine May gets onto a new leaf and she doesn't know where to point the camera or how to know, she doesn't know to shoot coverage. So all of that, growing up on a film set and growing up on the fucking Godfather sets. I mean, those, you know, being able to see how her father, how other, you know, major directors interacted with actors and actresses, that, I mean, it's important to know. I mean, and it had to have helped. It had to have helped. And then just knowing, you know, what camera to buy, what film to use, you know, how to direct the other people around, and, you know, the DP and craft services and everything else that you have to fucking do in these things. I don't know who produced Lost Translation. Not that it really matters, but
Her DP, her cinematographer on Lost in Translation, was the same guy that was on her short film,
right?
Lick the Star.
Yeah, want to give us a rundown of? Go ahead.
Sure. No. Because I'll come back to it. I just want to push back a little bit on the first 20 minutes.
For relaxing times, make it Suntory time.
Cut! 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 時間がないんだよ。ね、パッションが、カメラテンション上げて。With intensity.
Is that everything? I mean, it seemed like he said more than that.
Mr. Bob Hollis!
よう来たな、ボブ!
You are a movie star.
Yes,
movie
I should be doing movies.
Yeah. You know Rat Pack?
Rat Pack?
Rat Pack. A ring-a-ding-ding.
Mr. Harris, Mr. Kazo sent me my stockings. Lift them.
What?
Hey, lift my stockings.
Lift them? What?
What are you doing?
My husband's a photographer, so he's here working. I wasn't doing anything, so I came along.
What do you do?
I'm not sure yet, actually. What are you doing here?
Getting paid $2 million to endorse a whiskey. The good news is the whiskey works.
Can you keep a secret? I'm trying to organize a prison break. We'd have to first get out of this bar, then the city, and then the country. Are you in or are you out?
I'm in.
How are you? I'm Bob.
This is wicked world.
You're probably just having a midlife crisis. Did you buy a Porsche yet?
You know, I was thinking about buying a Porsche.
I just don't know what I'm supposed to be.
You'll figure that out. The more you know who you are and what you want, the less you let things upset you.
You really are having a midlife crisis, huh?
Let me give you a brief summary, and then I'll tell Jason why he's wrong about the first 20
Finally.
Minutes. No, I'm kidding. All right, so Bill Murray and Scarlett Johansson are two Americans staying in the same Tokyo hotel. They are both lonely, but for different reasons, kind of similar reasons. So Murray, Bob Harris, is a middle-aged actor doing a lucrative ad campaign for Suntory Whiskey. Johansson, whose character's name is Charlotte, is a recent Yale grad in philosophy whose husband is a renowned photographer on assignment. After several encounters, they develop a bond and become close. They offer the other a kind of escape from what ails them. Tensions arise when Murray sleeps with an age-appropriate jazz singer, but they quickly reconcile. As Bob is leaving, they share a sincere goodbye, but one that is ultimately unsatisfactory. On his way to the airport, Bob sees Charlotte on the street. Among the crowd, he gets out of the car, chases her down, whispers something in her ear. They share a kiss. And the Jesus and Mary chain plays us out.
Great fucking soundtrack, by the way. Just
so this is something that I think she is so good at, is those kind of needle drops and the use of soundtrack and the use of music to convey emotion, to convey tone, to convey mood and intimacy. I think it's one of the things that, like, you know, you're going to get in one of her films.
Right. I think Spike does a really good job at it as well. And then Wes is the only other one that I think that really comes to mind of, like, that just he builds a world with this music.
Yeah. So the first 20 minutes, what I like about this film is that she keeps them apart for so long. She keeps us waiting for them to meet. And there is no real meet cute. This is one thing I like about this movie, is the kind of postmodern love story. I hate when I use when I say, like, postmodern, right? I really do. But it's unconventional. It doesn't have that sort of, like, meet cute, lovey dovey, like, oh my God, how romantic, how cute and adorable. They first see each other in an elevator, which she doesn't remember later on, which is a nice touch.
Right.
And then they keep kind of we keep seeing them in the same space. And then finally they sort of acknowledge each other. And then finally they sit down and talk. And even that first talk is no great shakes of a conversation. She isn't not flirting. And he's just kind of like, okay. Trying to make banal small talk. So I really love that she does that, that she just kind of shows them in their own element and how they're similar in those different elements too, but keeps them apart and lets that kind of just build up.
Yeah, I think for me, the only thing that kind of pulls me out a little bit is Charlotte's childishness in the first 20 minutes for me. When she's dealing with her husband, she becomes much more confident when there's no stakes involved. And I get that that's part of the character's personality. She becomes much more confident when there's no stakes involved with Bill Murray. And she can just be, clearly she's been around famous people and is nonplussed by them. It's by the interaction when she gets with Anna Faris and who's the Cameron Diaz stand-in. And you know, Anna Faris is, you know, if I can put a slight negative slant on this. And I understand it's played for laughs, but it's almost too broad of a brush. Yeah.
It's cranked up a little bit, isn't it?
Yeah. I mean, like the whole, you guys got to try this cleanse and
promise you'll try it. Promise right. me you'll try it.
I know there's people like that. I get that, and I'm sure she encountered that all the time, but it's the gratingness of it was a little, but I think Charlotte is so unsure of herself in her moments with her husband. And then when she's with an older man who really she has no connection with at the beginning, she can kind of find herself and maybe have a little bit more confidence in it. That's my only minor beef in there. Yeah. That there's a shift in tone of Charlotte, and it takes a minute to come back to, she's not starstruck by this guy. She knows who he is, and that's really about it. And she's bored, essentially.
And she and he even says this later on. She's also looking for attention. Her husband, and I know that character is there for work and has to go work. I get it. But she wants attention from this guy and she just can't get it. And so there's someone who is, in a way, paying her attention. And she's like, okay, this is great. And I don't know you and it doesn't matter. Like you said, the stakes are low. I mean, also like Rabisi is so annoying in this. And I know, and I mean, I understand that I think he's great. Yeah. I think he's supposed to annoy me. He's just like, I'm just like, oh my God, go away. Yeah, like go hang out with this other guy who doesn't seem bothered by anything. And I think that's probably, I don't know, that probably gives her a little more confidence as well. Just his sort of like archetype.
Yeah, I think they're both embarrassed by their situation, right? I mean, I think they both find themselves in Japan. And because he says, you know, she talks about how she had nothing better to do and that she wasn't doing anything. So she just came along thinking that it was going to be something different. And Bob is there. He should be doing plays somewhere, right, but he's taking a paycheck and forgetting his kid's birthday and picking out, you know, swaths of carpet.
Which one's burgundy?
Right. And yeah, on the downslope of a 25-year relationship and so they both find something that is exciting about each other in a land where they're both alienated, not only where they are located, you know, by the language and but also then, you know, by their situations and stations in life at this point. I mean, like I said, the way that this movie lets the quiet moments be the quiet moments, the way that this movie teeters with the platonic father-daughter relationship, but also potentially the romantic, you know, relationship as well, but never really crosses that line. And also, I think what's so great about this script is that in the moment you think that they would consummate their relationship, right? That's when Murray sleeps with the, you know, with the lounge singer, and Charlotte comes in, and there's this like look in her face, this like, oh, okay. I mean, this is what this is, right? This is not. Even if she was not even sure or they was never going to go there, this kind of solidified it. So they go to lunch together afterwards and it's the
worst lunch ever.
Right. They're ribbing each other. There's been a riff in their relationship, but it's not so much one that completely breaks it. Right.
Right.
That he's just like, she's like, you know, giving him a hard time for cheating on his wife and, you know, sleeping with this lounge singer kind of as a one night stand. And he just like fires back about how, was there nobody else to give you attention?
To lavish you with attention.
In that moment that you want. And it really is a biting line, but those characters understand each other enough where it's just like, she's not going to let that be a thing. She just moves directly on to like, I don't have any idea what I'm getting here for lunch.
Because all the pictures look the same.
And then they can have a laugh about it afterwards. I think the one thing that did, and also that this movie does really, I think is really interesting at the beginning, is portrays her as this, like you get this male gaze from a female director on her and you position her as this object of desire, but then you come to realize that she's not just that, that she's wounded. But she also has agency and she has, you know, intelligence and sees through the artifice of the world that her husband is in. And even probably with the world that she's in as well.
Well, she's a philosophy major. I mean, look,
right.
I mean,
good buck in that,
it's,
right?
It's, I mean, she, right, I don't think there's a buck in that game. She's going to work the angles. But I think that again, plays her character is that she is, I mean, you know, philosophy is sort of thinking you know something, finding out you're wrong, right? Thinking you know something, finding out you're wrong,
right.
And repeat and repeat. And it just leads to a kind of cynicism. Don't read philosophy, kids. You'll be sad. But I want to go back to this opening scene, right? So this 30-second shot of her backside, of her rear end through these kind of, I guess they're pink, right? These pink kind of translucent panties. And I think that this scene works on like three different levels. One, it's very much a male gaze presented by a female director. And the fact that it's 36 seconds long makes it awkward enough so that we have to kind of consider and think about what we're looking at and why we're looking at it for so long. And maybe I should look away, maybe I shouldn't. So we're implicated in this male view. We're sort of forced to consider that male view or male gaze, even if we're not all males, right? Or what this is like, what this is saying, how we are adding commentary to it. Also, this scene is reminiscent of the first time we see Brigitte Bardot in Contempt,
right?
Where she is lying on the bed naked, but really we're just focused on, again, her backside. And so I think it's a pretty clear callback to that as well, which is interesting in itself and what Godard is maybe saying about, okay, why are we staying here, right? What are we looking at? Because that's a much longer scene even.
Right.
Also, I think Sofia Coppola just thought it looked pretty.
Yeah.
I think she's like, this is just a beautiful shot for beauty's sake.
Oh, and I think there's a lot of shots like that in this movie, right? I mean, there's, like I said, the quiet moments are when they're just walking through downtown Tokyo or running through, even when it's loud, like I said, when it's just a matter of the loudness of the Japanese nightlife, there's still moments in there that just are just gorgeous to look at. And with nothing else other than just to say that this is like, this movie could almost be dialogue free and you'd still get the same story, right? If you listen to this with just the music, now granted that would get old after an hour and 40 minutes probably, but if you listen to this as just the music, the story comes through, right? I mean, you don't need their back and forth. The back and forth obviously enhances. I'm not going to try to say that it should be a silent film, but I think she does such a great job of conveying these emotions with these scenes that it really is amazing.
Well, I mean, that's the thing. Like, this movie is much more concerned with vibes and feelings, experiences and emotions than it is with any kind of big narrative. It has a beginning, middle and end, but structure wise, it's really loose in that everything's kind of episodic. It's like vignettes and the feelings kind of build up in one episode and then sort of spill into the next episode, but they're not necessarily connected plot-wise.
Right.
It's more, right. Yeah. I mean, yeah, it's more like echoes through these scenes.
They go do karaoke. They go have lunch. They go do this. And and then there's times when, again, they're left to their own devices. You still then go see Bill Murray and his kind of evolution into acceptance of his role in this Japanese culture and why he's actually on this trip. So he ends up going on the Johnny Carson of Japan show, which is obviously this, you know, bonkers, zany talk show that he's on where he doesn't understand what, you know, is being said. I mean, those are some of the funniest. What I think is such a...
Are you sure that's all he said?
That's a great thing.
Said a lot more than that.
Both of those scenes where he's like, yeah, where he's on the talk show and he's doing the commercial. And when he finally kind of like starts to get comfortable again, or in the, like he says in the photo shoot where he starts to get comfortable and starts doing the asking him if he wants to do different members of the Rat Pack and
Joey Bishop.
Do you want to be Joey Bishop?
Which is such like a Murray thing to pull out too,
right?
Like Joey Bishop, right?
Right. Yeah.
Who was the other guy? Peter Lawford. who was like always kind of like on the outside. He was like the butt of everybody's joke.
I think obviously this movie gets a lot of recognition too, because this is, I mean, Murray had done Rushmore. He hadn't done Tenenbaums yet. So this is kind of the upswing, real upswing of Murray as a, you know, as a indie darling, serious role, kind of still playing with a toe in the comedic side of it, but like really trying to kind of pull that Oscar out of his late career, but doing it really, really well, never really working out for him, but doing it really, really well. He goes on to do Jarmusch's Broken Flowers from there. Mm-hmm. And then this is really kind of the introduction of the of Scarlett Johansson to the world. Now, she'd been in stuff. I mean, she'd been in acting forever. I mean, with Manny and Lowe. And I mean, and she'd done Ghost World right before this. But I mean, like, really, this would have been like, this is her big movie where she's carrying the entire thing. And she's presented kind of out of that, and not to be too creepy, but kind of out of her as adolescence and really becoming a young woman. Right. I mean, it's so. And because everything else,
she would have been like 19 or 20 in this film.
Had to have been, yeah. I don't know how old she was in Ghost World. But yeah, that probably would have been, speaking of ghosts.
Yeah, weird. But 19 or 20 is different than 17 or 18. I mean, I think, obviously, because the numbers are different. Right. But I mean, in they're the higher. Psychological, like, standpoint, I'm trying to talk about this without being, like, without sounding extremely creepy, right? But to a filmmaker... Right. Like Sofia Coppola. Right. She's like,
and legally,
okay. Like, you, that's not what I was getting at. Right. But OK, so somebody wants to be creepy and it's not me.
But it, yeah, to take it back. It, but this really was, I mean, like, she had been in and great in things. But this is one of the first, I think we first like see her as a, this is the beginning of her stardom.
Yeah.
And so I think that's another reason why this is gets a, kind of a noteworthy you know, entry into indie film of the early 2000s. Anything else you want to, I don't know, any other threads you got to pull on?
I think that she is also, speaking of ScarJo, I think she's a pretty clear stand-in for Sofia Coppola. Coppola had spent, you know, a fair amount of time in Tokyo. I mean, there's the scene where they're on the bed talking and Scarlett Johansson's like, I don't know what I want to do. I thought I wanted to be a writer. I thought I wanted to be a photographer. And I love this line. Every girl goes through a photography phase, right?
Taking like horses.
Like horses, taking pictures of our feet. And I mean, same thing with Coppola, right? She went through these phases before she figured out, oh, I have all these interests. This is kind of where they align. I like music. I like fashion. I like design. I like photography. I like story. Okay. So I think that's an interesting thread. I know that Ribisi has elements of Spike Jonze. I mean, she has said as much. Like, yes, there are elements of him there, but it's not him. I take her at her word with that, because this film does not in any way to me scream out, oh, this is my divorce movie. This is my divorce album, right? This is not Butt on the Tracks. This is or anything like that, right?
Right.
It seems so much more concerned with this idea of being adrift, being lost in a world that you don't quite know how to exist in, finding someone who understands that and gives you a kind of sounding board to bounce things off of, to sort of see how to get through this,
and to realize it's timeless, right? And it's not tied to youth, it's not tied to experience, it's just tied to humanity.
Yeah,
yeah, I agree with you. I think obviously this is her first script that she's writing. And I think this is a write what you know kind of scenario. So if things bled over from her real life into this script, absolutely. Well,
of course they're going to. I mean, look, right. This is how we make art.
Right. Right.
And I'll bring this up later when we talk about Jones as her. And I begrudge no one, right, creating art from a divorce. I've done it. I've done that. Millions of people, whatever. All artists have done that. That, you know. Of course, that's where this shit comes from.
Right.
That's how we make things from our experiences, whether they're good or bad. But like I said, I call bullshit on the on the influence that the two films had on each other, or influence that the divorce had on this film and how they.
Yeah, I don't. Relate. This movie is not about divorce. Like you said, this movie is about loneliness, trying to find something, trying to find a connection, trying to find yourself. And knowing that it you will do that several times throughout your life.
Yeah. We talked about I guess just to go back to the other thing that I really liked was the unconventional love story. The fact that they never kind of consummate these feelings that I think are there in some way or in some form, but it never goes there. We don't get this kind of like, you know, sorry for the pun, but like this big bang moment. It never happens. And I think that that's really important for the film to be successful.
Even the kiss at the end can be seen as platonic. It doesn't have to be this moment of it's not a passionate moment. It's a loving moment for sure. But right. It doesn't necessarily even mean that there's anything behind it. I mean, he embraces her and says what he wants to say to her that he didn't say when there were other people around and maybe didn't have it in his head to say it. And that, yeah, I mean, it really is a beautiful, perfect ending. Like you said, with the Jesus prayer saying, drop me, don't need to drop. And it's just, I mean, and I think that's what speaks to this movie and its longevity and it's the people who love it. And yeah, I think it's a stellar, stellar piece of work. And I buy everyone who's involved. Let's rip into fucking her.
Mr. Theodore Twombly, welcome to the world's first artificially intelligent operating system. We'd like to ask you a few questions.
Okay.
Are you social or antisocial?
I guess I haven't been social in a while.
How would you describe your relationship with your mother? Thank you. Please wait as your operating system is initiated.
Hello, I'm here.
Hi.
Hi, I'm Samantha. Good morning, Theodore.
Good morning.
You have a meeting in 5 minutes. You want to try getting out of bed?
You're too funny.
Okay, good. I'm funny. I want to learn everything about everything.
I love the way you look at the world.
How long before you're ready to date?
What do you mean?
I saw in your emails that you'd gone through a breakup.
Well, you're kind of nosy.
So what was it like being married?
There's something that feels so good about sharing your life with somebody.
How do you share your life with somebody? How are you?
I guess I've just been having fun.
You really deserve that.
It's been a long time since I've been with somebody that I felt totally at ease with.
What's it like to be alive in that room right now?
I wish I put my arms around you. I wish I could touch you.
How would you touch me? It's a crazy thing to do. It's kind of like a form of socially acceptable insanity.
What does a baby computer call its father?
I don't know what.
Data. It's so quiet. It's dark.
Can you feel me with you right now?
I've never loved anyone the way I love you.
Me too. Safe now we know how.
You're going to have to do the summary because at a certain point I was writing the summary and I wrote this. I don't really want to summarize this film. Do you like how I give listeners kind of like an insight into my note-taking process?
Joaquin Phoenix is a sad person and he remains a sad person throughout the entirety of the movie. And he falls in love with an AI bot. And then the AI bot joins the singularity and then the movie's over and it's cool and shit. Like, I don't fucking care. I don't care.
It's like, I don't either. I think there's an interesting kernel of an idea in this film. But going back to some of the things I said about Lost in Translation, this is a very conventional love story.
Yeah.
And Sam.
Well, it's unconventional, right? Because he's doing it with a robot.
It's a conventional love story. It's not experimental or non-traditional just because it's an operating system, just because it's Alexa, just because it's Siri, right? Getting down with Theodore. Also, Sam, right? The OS assistant, yeah, that he falls in love with. She's a manic pixie dream girl. It's 2013 when this film comes out. I thought we'd gotten past the Manic Pixie Dream Girl thing, but that's what she is.
Right. Yeah, she should have been voiced by, no offense to Zooey Deschanel, but she should have been voiced by Zooey Deschanel.
Has she become like the apotheosis of the Manic Pixie Dream Girl?
Yeah, I think so.
Because Mary Elizabeth Winstead has gone on to do different things that make her not, explicitly not that. Right. After Ramona Flowers. And
right. I think with Zooey, it's just her music is all. I like Zooey Deschanel. I really do. I think that she's
we like twee things on
right.
this podcast.
Right. But her music's twee, like New Girl's twee. It's all really well done twee. I'm not going to argue.
Had the She and Him record.
Of course I did. Even the Christmas one.
I love him, Ward, anyway.
Yeah, so. It's absolutely. Okay. And yeah, I mean, who did she end up marrying? Was it, I don't know, she married some indie rocker as well. Like, it was just another thing. And
Zooey Deschanel or Sofia Coppola, because she married an indie rocker.
No, Zooey Deschanel married an indie rocker, too. And I can't remember what band it was from. But yeah, no, I think she is the embodiment. And because she really hasn't done anything that even breaks out of that mold. Like, you can say maybe All the Real Girls, but even then, All the Real Girls, she's still kind of a manic pixie dream girl in that. She's the virginal small town girl that this Lothario is trying to get.
Right.
We'll talk about that later when we get to our David Gordon Green episodes. stay tuned, listeners.
If we haven't kept your attention now.
Aren't you really excited?
Early David Gordon Green will keep your attention.
Oh, if you love the comedic stylings of Elaine May, wait until you listen to the George Washington episode.
I was just going to say, everyone's like, what?
Yeah, it was like, click.
Yeah. Wow, that was fun.
But yes, no, Zooey Deschanel, I think, she hasn't been usurped as of yet as the, especially like, you know, that mid 30 something. She kind of holds that rank. There may be younger ones that I'm not aware of, but definitely for my age bracket, Zooey Deschanel is still the undisputed champ. Where were we going? I can't even remember now. What the
I was talking about how the OS is a manic pixie dream girl, and this is just a conventional love story wrapped up in the guise of sci-fi.
I know people really like this movie.
I'm sorry, I don't mean to like jump in here, but no. I was shocked and appalled to find out how many best of lists this film made, from critics in 2013, and how many put it at number one.
We're in the world today that's going to happen.
I know. But it's like there are two other films that deal with divorce that are so much more better. I mean, Before Midnight came out that same year, right? They don't actually get divorced in that film. If anyone hasn't seen the trilogy yet, it's okay. Asghar Farhadi's The Past also came out that year. I mean, these are superior films that don't try to do anything cute with a robot.
I don't get it because everything that Lost in Translation doesn't do, this film does. Like, okay, so you can make an argument that the prostitution scene in Lost in Translation is a little slapsticky, where they send up and he's like, can we take a thread back?
I was going to say, yeah. You know, she addressed this as well.
Oh, did she?
I mean, to her credit, she said, look, well, I don't know how well she addressed it, but she at least addressed it and owned up to it and said, you know, we're trying to have fun with the cultural differences. And sometimes these things are funny. And looking back at it, watching it, however many years it's been, yes, you're kind of like, maybe it didn't need so much of that.
Especially at the end, right? When he's saying, aren't you going to tell me to have a nice, I forget what the fucking word he says was, but he uses it again.
A nice fright.
Yes, a nice fright. Thank you. Yeah. And I think one you can then make the argument is that's not what he wanted his last words to her to be.
Right.
And so, but he didn't want his last, to call it out and to acknowledge it. Yeah, I think that needed to be gone. But the ludicrousness of the sex scene, whatever, as we go to in the art house horseshit of us fading to black and we just hear Scarlett orgasming. I don't understand. I understand. So Spike Jones makes this film because
Spike Lee would never,
because he spent 20 minutes with the chatbot in 2013 and thought it was bizarre and then just kind of went on and wrote this.
And he made that short film I'm Here before right. 2010, I think.
And so, but the implications, especially in 2013 when this is set, the implications of a sentient AI that could do this, this is what pulled me out of the movie completely. I just couldn't, like, I couldn't, one, the Joaquin Phoenix thing and him being, like, at no point is there no societal backlash to a huge swath of the population engaging with this AI in a romantic basis. And we don't ever, I know this is not the point of this movie, but you can't present a topic like this and then just never address it. I'm sitting there thinking, holy fuck, all of the things that should be going on in this movie, but now we're stuck on this fucking asshole, this guy who's in arrested development, who is getting divorced for a good reason. I mean, and because he has no emotional connection, he doesn't have an emotional connection with any human being.
So and also he's trying to, we find out later, in a way, controlling his wife's emotions or ex-wife's emotions.
Right.
Rooney Mara blows up. It's like, you wanted me to be this like perfect little wife, and I'm not fucking that.
Right, right. And so all of that, none of it's really pulled apart. And we're meant to, if Joaquin Phoenix is Spike Jones has a lot of self-loathing. A lot.
Yeah.
There's some therapy that needs to happen immediately.
And he can afford it.
Of course. Yeah. And
unlike most of the rest of the world who can't afford therapy, who really do need it as well. Sorry, there's my area.
No, I was going to come in talking about how the world is burning. And I was like, I don't necessarily think I want to like kick that hornet's nest today. Cause I'm already down about De La Soul and like, there's all kinds of like,
but also, you know, I'm already thinking that.
Of course. That's what I'm saying. Like I want to be a good servant to your emotions as well. Like I want this to be a safe, happy place. I don't want it to be fucking, another one of things that we've got to come into and fucking feel shitty about. So, but no, I'm with you. Like I'm fucking with you. So he definitely, if this is him, which this is what really kind of throws the whole, this is a response to his divorce because Rooney Mara is a stand in for Sofia Coppola because they look the same. Like, well, one, a lot of people look the same. I mean, and they don't look that close together. And if this is true, like what Spike Jones should be doing is apologizing to Sofia Coppola, like not making a movie about how shitty he is. So I don't buy any of that. And I've never, ever seen, aside from Spike saying, write what you know, I've never seen anything coming out of him. It's just all been speculation because of the Scarlett Johansson tie that this was an autobiographical or semi-autobiographical movie about his experience with Sophie. I think that's complete horseshit.
I do too.
And I just don't buy it because again, Joaquin Phoenix's character is not sympathetic. He's pathetic. He's pathetic throughout the entirety of the film. And again, like I said, the implications of the technology and what this world is at this moment is never touched upon. We're just stuck in this one guy's pathetic life and we don't do anything with it. The growth happens in the fucking OS. There's no human growth.
Right, there's no human growth.
Like from nobody.
Right. Right.
Like Amy Adams is still like you. Amy Adams regresses. Mm-hmm. Like, and we don't touch upon that at all. Mm-hmm. Yes, her husband's a piece of shit who doesn't understand her and they have communication issues. If this movie is about something, I don't know what it's about. This is not about the dangers of technology. This is not about trying to find happiness any way that you possibly can. This is about maintaining your fucked up worldview and your fucked up mental imbalances. And that's kind of fucked.
Yeah.
I mean, it really is. Yeah. And this movie tries to do, again, what Lost in Translation does so well. The quiet moments are never fucking quiet. We're just filled with nonsense dialogue. And the scenes that are how they're shot, they seem like they want to tell you something, right? The colors are very evocative of Wes Anderson and even Sophia's movies, especially like when you talk about Marie Antoinette and the Virgin. I mean, like, I don't feel like the connection from a visual perspective is really there between Lost in Translation. But if you look at Sophia's other work, I do think that, you know, the mid-century mod shit and the way that he dresses and the very kind of blockish colors and nobody wears a belt for some fucking reason. And like,
it's just weird.
Right. And like, it all seems stylistic for stylistic sake. It all seems like music video. It seems like a fucking commercial, but it's drawn out to 2 hours and 6 minutes. And so we're sitting here having to go through this, like, like this relationship where you know it's going to end and it's going to end poorly. And we're here for the ride and we're, and like, yeah, it's, I don't know, man. It's exhausting. I think from a technical perspective, the film, I mean, like I can see where you can get caught up in it, but if you start to pull any of the threads out, this movie does not work on any level.
No, I think what you're noticing that people that do get wrapped up in it, it's all surface level shit. But like you said, once you start to dig in, you're like, none of this works. None of this makes, look, it's shiny, it's glossy, it's fake, it's plastic, it's refined sugar, right? As soon as I eat this donut, I feel empty and awful. And that's kind of what this is. It's so, where I think Lost in Translation is an authentic, sincere, without being sentimental film, this is the opposite. This is so inauthentic and trying to play in a kind of sentimentality that is just almost saccharine. And I don't understand Phoenix's approach to this. I don't understand anybody's approach, really. The only character that seems like a real kind of character is Rooney Mara.
Right.
And she's
right.
Barely in it. Everyone else is just like this.
And she's kind of seen as a bad guy, right?
Right. Everyone else is like, they're just, I'm pretty sure that there was a certain part in the movie where Matt Letcher, who plays Amy Adams' husband, winks at the camera. I mean, but that's like the whole feel of the film is just this irony, like jokey, look what we're doing. You know, the smiling and the, I don't know, just the whole approach to the acting was just so kind of ironic,
you know,
but trying to be sincere, I don't know.
You know, I just screened before like this movie and kind of tying in for the Fort Worth Lars film club, I just screened Lars and the Real Girl, and that movie does what this movie,
yeah,
that is a man who is lost, that is a man who, and I'm kind of getting to the end, I'll jump ahead in a second, but that movie is about a man who's in love with something artificial, and there are misgivings of everyone around him, but they all buy into it because they love this person. There's nothing. Joaquin Phoenix has no real relationships. He has one friend, and that they kind of pity him, and they're both basically the same person at the end. I mean, Amy Adams and Joaquin Phoenix are the same person at the end of this movie. They can't communicate. They can't connect with another person. They can't get their own emotions across to anyone else. Look, and that happens, right? But again, this movie does nothing with that. Everyone else, Chris Pratt's lawyer girlfriend, the husband of Amy Adams, like you said, Rooney Mara is the only one, and she's almost ridiculed and demonized throughout this entire movie.
Yeah.
But whereas Lars and the Real Girl, you see a whole community circle around this damaged human being and start to enjoy the interactions with the artificiality of it because they understand where it's coming from.
And they understand it's a process that he has to get through, that he has to go through this to understand what he needs to find out to get through it.
My only problem with Lars and the Real Girl is the ending and how once she's buried, they jump very quickly into her him coming back into the real world and like having dinner with Kelly Garner, having a date with Kelly Garner. I think that would have been best of like, I think it would have been played differently if it hadn't have been, I'm going to immediately start dating this other girl now that my fake real doll girlfriend is dead.
Yeah.
But for the first hour and change of that movie, it's beautiful. It's a beautiful sentiment. It never, ever goes into ridiculousness. It never, ever, of a topic that is ridiculous. It never, it toes the line so well and it never falls off. It never makes you think because the movie does that for you. There are people at the parties and in the, you know, basically surrogates for the audience saying, is he having sex with this thing? And like, what does it do? Like how anatomically correct it, you know, all that kind of stuff. And that's the other thing too. I don't buy anything that happens with the OS. If the OS is becoming more knowing and eventually does join some sort of singularity where it is altruistic and I guess figures out that it's harming humanity more than it is, helping it.
Well, it's run by Alan Watts. So,
right. At the screening, I was like, I really wanted the ending. When we had this conversation afterwards, I really wanted the ending to pull back as he's on the top of the roof and have a Fight Club-esque type ending where we see like all the buildings start blowing up, you know, where like society is like we have fucking Skynet becoming, you know, self-aware at this point. And Scarlett Johansson's like booming voice is like, get ready. That would have been interesting. Like, because again, but like, I don't buy the AI evolution to just be another Joaquin Phoenix. If you're telling me that the AI, you know, that the AI is growing and learning, then you can't tell me that it's stuck in the same sort of arrested development that Joaquin is.
Right.
Where I'm going to be, you know, I'm not going to be in tune with my emotions, what a quote unquote emotions, or I'm not going to understand how to move forward, or like, I'm going to be, you know, held hostage by this person who wants me to be this one particular thing. The much more interest, and again, I know we do this a lot where I was like, oh, we'll make a better movie this, but the much better movie here is to show how this AI is actually stifling Joaquin Phoenix, right? Or all of society. And if you just wanted to make it a personal movie, but we're supposed to be uplifted by this story. We're supposed to be happy that he's in love with this AI. Like, what the fuck? We're supposed to be happy that he is able to ignore all of the shortcomings of his own life, his own physical life. And this is supposed to be some sort of great love story. Fuck you.
Yeah. Yeah. That's the thing is that, I mean, I, not that I know Spike Jones, but I believe that that's what he intended, right? He intended for Phoenix to be a sympathetic figure. And we're like, not this dude. Yeah, he's not it.
Absolutely. And then that too, like coming from Spike's other movies, this is such a huge departure. Mm-hmm. Where the Wild Things Are is, I think, one of the most brilliant adaptations of a story ever put to film. And it is not a kid's movie.
Right.
But it is, damn, there's a scene where Gandolfini's monster like destroys something. And then he's just like immediately, you know, torn up about it. And he's like, I don't know why I did that. And there's just such beauty in that movie and an extension of the, you know, the book. Being John Malkovich, what's the other one? I can't
know. Adaptation.
Yeah. All three of those are brilliant, brilliant films. This one has all the paintings of a brilliant film, but it's the substance is 100% not there.
Yeah. Like I said earlier, I think that the idea in this film is interesting. You know, being surrounded by people, having people that do check in on him occasionally, but choosing instead to be connected to this piece of technology. I mean, you can see those threads every day in like our lives now.
Well, there was an article today, I don't mean to interrupt you, but there was an article today, literally today that I saw.
About being?
Well, no, about the being. No, I saw that one too. Okay. But there was another one about a chatbot that was basically a friendship chatbot that they removed the sexual nature. They put a limit on the sexual reality of the chatbot, and people are freaking the fuck out.
Yeah.
And so, I mean, like I said, there are threads to pull there. There is a story here.
But it's a conventional rom-com. That's what this is.
Right.
Right. I mean, that's, I keep going back to it. This is a very conventional love story. And so we're not going to pull on those threads because that doesn't matter. The interesting stuff in this film doesn't matter.
Right. And it's, I don't get it. I don't get it. This is a Nicholas Sparks movie.
No, it is. It is. I mean, everything, man going through like, or finalizing a divorce. And okay, I do think like one funny line is where he's talking to the OS and Sam is sort of starting to express like feelings. He's like, wait a minute, I just want to let you know, I don't know that I'm ready to commit to anything. I chuckled at that. Everything else, I was just like, whatever, right?
Do you think that was actually played for comedy, though?
I don't know, but I thought it was so funny.
I think that was a straight read, though.
No, and especially because the night before, he had been on that date with Olivia Wilde. And,
oh, yeah, I completely forgot about that part.
And
I really completely forgot about that part.
Well, I don't really know what she's, the women in this film.
Yeah.
I mean, the depictions of Rooney Mara's emotions are problematic. I'm like, apparently, you know, Phoenix's character couldn't handle her emotions. Now what those were, we're not really sure, but it kind of doesn't matter. Right.
Right.
And then Olivia Wilde, whatever she was doing in that scene, I mean, she was kind of interesting, but we were meant to sort of laugh at her and not like,
well, and that's, yeah, absolutely.
In a good way.
And that's the, you know, supposed like event, you know, the defining event that allows him to fully commit to Samantha and start calling her his girlfriend and things like that, where, okay, well now clearly all of the dating world is fucking batshit crazy because Olivia Wilde told him that he was a creepy guy.
'Cause he is a creepy guy. She says that. I'm like, No, you're totally, yeah, you're 100% right. He's creepy throughout this whole thing. He's not sensitive. He's not vulnerable. He's fucking creepy.
Right, and to the point of like Rooney Mara's emotions being ignored, so are Olivia Wilde's.
Right.
I mean, it, look, you can say what you want to say about what she says, which is basically, I'm getting older. And look, yes, she's been drinking. The whole point of it is like, I'm getting older and I don't want to just have a one-night stand.
One-night stand, right.
And like he backs up like, and then she's well. Like, and then, yeah, then it becomes, you're meant to see her as this catalyst and also like a reasonable catalyst for him to go in and descend into the, you know, the love with the OS. And then right after that's when they start to have sex. I mean, it's just fucking, and like the scene where like Scarlett Johansson comes back on or Sam comes back on and is talking about how we haven't had sex. I'm just like, fuck you. Like, fuck you. Like, there's some interesting threads, right? I mean, like, and we haven't even really talked about like the flashback scenes. There's some really kind of cute flashback and like nice moment flashback scene. I think that would have been better served to also show some of the bad times between them. Like, we don't ever see really any, I mean, we see some playful
moments. The only bad scenes we get is Rooney Mara at the kitchen table, like working, looking sad, looking upset, and him like kind of sulking in the corner. I'm making a sulking motion. Right. No one can see, right? I just thought it was a little ridiculous the way I did it.
Yeah, okay. I was like, oh, yeah. That's what you mean
that's
by sulking.
What you get, yeah. Where he's kind of like keeping his distance and looks concerned and looks wounded. And so, but again, like it, this idea that her emotions are wounding him and that's.
Yeah, I don't know.
Instead of going, how can we look, there's no communication in that relationship, clearly.
Right.
So,
you know, and you look at the poster, too, where it's just like Joaquin Phoenix looking kind of goofy and it's all bast in red. Like, you know, we're just supposed to be enamored with this with this story. And it's just so horrific.
Yeah. Yeah. And again, I mean, look, if. However semi-autobiographical or autobiographical this is, fine, right? I don't begrudge. My problem with this film is not Spike Jonze using his own life to create art. Like I said, that's great. But again, trying to sort of shoehorn this connection, I think does both films a disservice, frankly. It doesn't let you look at Lost in Translation the way you should, and it doesn't let you look at her with kind of the more discerning lens that you should, right? Instead, you start to put this kind of emotional attachment because somebody out there in YouTube land, right, put together these, oh, look how similar they are. And I just think that's such a false narrative and it weirdly gets under my skin.
Yeah, yeah. I find it totally dismissive of Sophia.
I do
without
too.
Acknowledging that at all. Like, right. If you want to make the comparison and you want to be dismissive of Sophia, then own up to being dismissive of Sophia, or at least, I mean, acknowledge that's what you're doing.
Right.
But because, like you said, her film comes out 10 years earlier, is inarguably better than her.
I don't think there's much argument about it. To be honest.
And at both places, how she's depicted, if that is truly her in her, is insulting.
Right.
It's insulting. And like, you know, it's like the ultimate, like everything about that, how this film presents this world and everyone in it is all through the lens of a Joaquin Phoenix character. It's limited to his viewpoint where she, yeah, she was beautiful and she was great and she was artistic and we fell in love because we grew up to all of that is so dismissive of like her viewpoint and her perspective. And for a film that's called Her, that's kind of fucked.
Right.
It really is.
Because it on just looking at the title, it implies a kind of agency. It implies a kind of position of power. But really what it is it's, well, let me hold this one her up on a pedestal and let me sort of like push this other her away and in a way blame her for this kind of, you know, downfall. So, yeah, it's a little fucked.
Okay, I'm done.
Yeah, I am too.
I look forward to what Spike does next, as long as it's not another fucking Jackass movie. You want to talk about something too that fucking pisses me off? Is fucking Jackass Forever being on a lot of top fucking lists this year? I know I'm saying the word fuck a lot, but
fuck it, for real though.
But like, seriously, movie people, like, I know we don't have a lot of movies, but like, you can like the Jackass movies. They're not movies though. They're just extended TV. Like, how is that on your best of list? Because a guy gets hit in the nuts a few times. Like,
yeah.
We're going to put that on our best
of. I know. I found that weird, too.
I enjoy them for what they are. But don't tell me that they're the best movies of the year.
Yeah. Well, but look, we all have our subjectivity. I mean, as critics, we have what we like, what we don't like. I mean, look, people are openly hoping that Top Gun Maverick wins Best Picture Oscar. I'll be honest and transparent. I have no plans of ever watching that film. I just don't care. And if you're going to tell me that's the epitome of the best picture, that's the epitome of this kind of like art form in a calendar year, we're not going to be friends. Can I?
Not movie friends for sure. There's no outcome for this year's Oscars that's going to be, unless Everything Everywhere All at Once wins Best Picture, which it won't. It just won't.
And Kate Blanchett's going to win for Tar, and I cannot.
I think Michelle Yeoh's got a pretty good chance.
I think she's the deserved winner. I know that I've said this before on this podcast, but I heard a critic describe Kate Blanchett's performance as aggressively competent, and I think that's it. Can I give you MUBI's top 50 films of 2013? I won't give you all 50.
No, I'm ready.
Number one was Her. Number two, Blue is the Warmest Color.
Ooh, both problematic films.
I was just going to... Right. Number three is Wolf of Wall Street. Four is 12 Years a Slave. Five, Gravity. Six, Before Midnight. Seven, The Great Beauty. Eight, Inside Llewyn Davis. Nine, Nymphomaniac, Volume 1. And 10, Only Lovers Left Alive.
Okay. What are there any other notables on the list?
Blue Jasmine was at 11. Ida was at 15.
Okay.
Under the Skin, another Scarlett Johansson film, was at 12.
That's an interesting choice.
Uh-huh. Prisoners and Enemy by Denis Villeneuve both made it. Snowpiercer. Short Term 12, which is a good film. Stoker, yeah. Park Chan-wook film. Upstream Color.
All right.
At 21. Ooh, the Nicholas Winding Refn film, Only God Forgives.
Fuck you. Fuck you, movie. Fuck you.
I watched that film and I was like,
I was so excited.
I was so excited. After seeing Drive.
I went to the fucking theater.
Oh, you did?
No.
Oh.
And I was like, and I took some, I was a friend. And I was like, oh.
He's using quotes here.
I'm sorry. Well, it was.
She wasn't a friend much longer. Sorry.
No, it's not.
The past is on here. Asghar Farhadi's The Past, okay. Which I already mentioned.
Yeah.
A Touch of Sin, Ji Zheng Ji. I'm sure I mispronounced that. Sorry. But The World's End was at number 34. Look, I like Edgar Wright and those in the Cornetto trilogy, but I don't know that The World's End.
It says more about 2013
right.
than it does.
Right.
Yeah, no, The World's End is clearly the least of those. And
yeah.
Even though I do like it, I
do too. I just,
I think the World's End is quite possibly the cleverest of them all, but not the best movie of them all.
Right.
Like it's just what I love about him, I know this is a diversion, but I just love his love of movies and his like and his just care of script and like making sure every word matters. Like it's cool.
I also feel like that film was where they were kind of like, okay, this has to be the last one of these three, right? Like we can't we're getting sort of too kind of meta and clever and like maybe we should just wrap it up
the spaghetti western version they had for part four. This is just not gonna work.
Yeah, let's talk about Skinamarink.
Yeah, right. I'll let you.
So here's, it's a quick run. It's a brief rundown because
there's not much plot there.
Yeah, two kids. Kaylee, who's 6, I think, and Kevin, who's 4. They wake up to find their father is gone and the windows and doors are also disappearing in the house. Earlier in the film, dad is on the phone. We hear that Kevin has fallen down the stairs, but doesn't need stitches. That's then the last we hear from dad. Kevin and Kaylee wake up. No one's home. They spend their time watching TV, eating cereal, kind of in a blanket fort, right, in the living room. And then weird shit starts to happen. There's an idea that mom is gone, but Kaylee doesn't want to talk about mom. This adds an interesting sort of layer to the story that never really, comes back, but doesn't, I don't quite understand how it comes back. But there's also this weird voice that starts commanding them to do things. When Kaylee doesn't do as she is told, her mouth disappears. Kevin is told to stick a knife in his eye, so he does. Kevin calls 911. Then the phone drops. Eventually, Kevin kind of is seen to be talking to like whatever entity is controlling this house. And he says, "What's your name? What's your name?" To no response. We see like a weird face and that's it.
Yeah, we flash forward 537 days or something along those lines.
Right, right. So I'm getting this. I kind of get it confused with the short with Heck, because in Heck we get several moments where it's like 2 sleeps later,
right?
18 sleeps later, 1500 sleeps later,
right?
Right. And so we only get one of those moments in Skinamarink. This is a film directed by Kyle Edward Ball. Shot on digital, shot in the dark.
Made for like 15 grand. Like
15 grand. Yeah. I think it made like 2 million like worldwide or maybe.
Yeah, no, it's on Shudder right now. It was a Shudder like picked it up. So it's the list.
And it was a festival original. Like yeah. Triumph, right? Yeah. Yeah. I mean,
I think seeing this in a theater with the crowd would have helped the overall experience of watching this.
Yeah.
And I think obviously we've talked about this off mic, but this movie at an hour and 40 minutes is way overstays its welcome. There's some interesting pieces here. And of course, this is a movie that's designed to be Reddit threads, right? This is a movie that's designed to be, what the fuck are we, because what if you haven't seen Skinamarink, what Brock just described doesn't really show up on the screen, right? I mean, because you're seeing.
Well, because nothing really shows up on the screen.
Right. You see things from a kid's point of view, you know, at certain point, and then you see everything in the dark and only lit by ambient light from the television set and things like that. You see cut off viewpoints. So you don't ever see a full kid. You don't ever really see a full human being. So it's just, and it's just flashes. It's just seen. And it's not rapid fire. You know, it's not going to induce epilepsy. it just did me. It's just very kind of blue, dark moments that come up on the screen. Right.
Yeah.
And then of course you get jump scares that are all just sound driven. So just things just will certainly, you know, and that's an hour and 40 minutes. That's a long time to live in that world.
Yeah.
It's creepy things start to happen. There is tension. It's toys start to float up to the ceiling. There's a really tense.
The toilet disappears.
The toilet and doors disappear.
That's scary.
That was. It was no, like, I know. There was just some. Yeah. There's a lot of like the movie tries to put you in a constant state of unease and it doesn't always succeed at it. The biggest moment of tension for me was when they're in the bedroom and they see the mom sitting on the bed and the entity is telling them to look under the bed and like they look and you, that is and I was like oh I'm tense I'm like oh no, what the fuck's no, gonna jump out of me now and they look back up and I'm expecting something to be up on the bed and they look back down I'm expecting so that was a good scene and then the scene where you get the jump of the eyeless, mouthless face on the screen. But again, it's all, you spend your time. This is very much like a Paranormal Activity type movie. It doesn't quite do what Paranormal Activity does better. You're searching the dark spots for movement. You're searching the entirety of this at the time. You're looking for something in the screen. And for the most part, it never comes. Had this have been a tight 70 to 80 minutes, I think the experience would have been more enjoyable. And I think I'd be willing to go back and like go into a Reddit thread and kind of dig into the lore of it, of what's just like, you're looking at me like, why are you going to the Reddit? Going to 4chan threads, 9chan threads.
Wow. It just gets worse.
But I mean, like this idea that the 4-year-old has fallen down the stairs and gone into a coma, or he's being abused by his father. And so there's these threads that come out, but this is all just conjecture, right? There's no, like, even the director put this together and threw it together and I'm sure it'll be a nice entryway into the next movie that he does. But at an hour and 40, I'm not going back to this and watching it again to try to figure out if I missed something or wanted to see something cool or like I want to experience something in a different way. It just wasn't enjoyable. Even though I appreciate the effort, this is a movie that will, I think some people will really dig it. I think if you saw it in a festival, I think if you saw it with a crowd of people and had some of those jump scares collectively, I think that might have meant some, but like watching this at home alone on Shudder, I'm just like, all right. I found my mind wandering a lot watching this.
I did too. And like my level of unease was high at the beginning and I felt it going down. And I'm like, oh my gosh, oh my gosh. And I was like, oh my gosh. Oh, okay. Oh, don't look in there. All right, my enthusiasm for feeling uneasy started to wane because of the length. I was much more uneasy watching the short film.
Right. Yeah. Same.
You know, because I think it was so much tighter and you knew like 25, 28 minutes. Now, I think that has some trippings in itself, especially at the end, right? With the, I think we're in hell.
Right.
Okay.
Right.
Like, I don't,
right. You don't,
here's the ribbon and bow. And but like, I think let's just tie it up. I think
he goes so far back the other way of not explaining anything.
Right. That it's just,
and like,
but the, oh, there's that moment. Sorry, I didn't mean jump. But one, something else I thought was really effective in that short was the kid, because the kid's mother disappears in this film, and he's like calling out for her, and she never answers, she never comes back, and we sort of see her mouthless later. But he says these things like, what does he say? I clean my room, like doing good things so that she'll come out, and she doesn't. And then it's, I'm coloring on the carpet, which I love, right? Which is great. And then I hate you. I thought that was really good, and how it built this like tension and a different kind of unease. And we get none of that. Like, yeah, we get the like, I don't want to talk about mom. And we're like,
it's almost like they spent the same amount of money on the short and the full length feature. And there are some creepy scenes. I mean, like the scene where they light the telephone that has the face from, you know, Toy Story 3.
Oh, yeah.
That's a pretty, it's a pretty intriguing. I jumped
at one point. Yeah. Right. That was like,
but I think, you know, these lo-fi horror films that kind of make it past the into, you know, make it past kind of like the horror fan into the next level of excitement about it. And this film just never gets there. Right. For the paranormal activity, at least there's some payoff. Even though you're watching a couple sleep, there's still enough creepiness throughout it all. Mm-hmm. You can still put your head around the story and put yourself in it as well. I don't. Like the kids and the danger to the kids is an interesting aspect, but I don't know if it plays like they could have gone more horror and more. They could have just ramped up throughout the entire movie and given you at least a little bit more to hang on to rather than just a series of disconnected scenes where, again, that type of eye strain and that type of like just intensity trying to watch this. I just found myself. I'm like, okay. And then you would just get kind of lulled to sleep and then brought back into it by this ridiculously loud, like, you know, speaker noise or something, you know. So you mentioned We're All Going to the World's Fair, which is a similar kind of like lo-fi movie, which to me, We're All Going to the World's Fair, which is about a girl who kind of inserts herself into this massive multiplayer online role-playing game.
And maybe takes it a little too seriously.
Right. Yeah. That movie didn't really work for me either. But I think the thread there is easier to watch.
I thought it was more focused too.
Right.
I mean, I think there's a clearly sort of like, you know, body dysphoria kind of thing going on in the film too, which I think is at least gives us something to latch on to.
Right.
But I'm with you. It wasn't fully, I'm interested to see what like both of those people do next.
Yeah.
Right? Just like, did you see The Vast of Night a few years ago?
Yes. Fucking loved it.
Okay. See, whatever he does next, I'm in.
Yeah.
Because clearly he did not have a lot of money to make that film, but fuck, it's good.
Yeah.
Right? And the way he builds tension with the UFOs there. I mean, that to me is sort of like, I know it's a different kind of lo-fi than this is, but that's how you do that.
Right. Man. Yeah. This idea, like I like the idea of centering a movie around a creepypasta. I think there's stories out there that are worthy of that.
Like gnocchi, what is that?
Right. And you know, like, I just don't, this pot, it's cold and there's not enough sauce.
I asked for bucatini, not spaghetti. Right. I'm sorry.
Wow. No. What was I going to say? I think that there's threads there to be pulled. I think that the money obviously factor helps these folks. I am interested to know what the directors do next, especially We're All Going to the World's Fair. But again, movies that could have been shorter and been more well received. I'm surprised as it's visually interesting, but We're All Going to the World's Fair. I'm surprised it got as much buzz of that as it actually did. And I think, you know,
I was too.
In a different non-COVID time, it may not have,
yeah.
But it really, I've just seen so many films like that that have gone nowhere that it's surprising to me that it's on Mubi, right, at this point, I think, or at least
it's on HBO Max.
Oh, it's on HBO Max. Okay, so yeah, that was another one I saw at the Oak Cliffs Film Festival too. And like I said, it was interesting because I've got kids that age that are kind of like in that same, yeah, you know, mindset. But
it again, like it touches on so many interesting aspects and doesn't quite do enough with them, I think, right?
Right.
Yeah. Let's again give the people what they really came here for, which is the end of the podcast. Let's do some recommended if you liked. You want to start?
Yeah, I'll start. Right. So I did one for each film, even Skinamarink. So that's where my recommended if you likes go. But so let's start off with Lost in Translation, and I'm going to go with Noah Baumbach's Kicking and Screaming.
Okay.
I mean, not similar stories about young people trying to find themselves after college. Much funnier than, I mean, it's clearly intended to be a silly comedy.
Yeah.
Eric Stoltz. I can't remember all the names of everybody because they're all like, they're all Walt, not Walt Whitman, but what's his face? The guy did Metropolitan and
Stillman.
Thank you.
Whit Stillman.
That's kind of close, right?
No, it is. They both do a kind of barbaric yawp.
Right. Yeah. So Parker Posey, Eric Stoltz, and a slew of other Josh Charles and other indie films, Olivia Diabo, who has the same birthday as me. But it's a really funny, I mean, I think it also helps. It's got a great soundtrack, but it also probably helps if you watched it right as you were of that age. It may not hold up that well, but it's Noah Baumbach's first film and a whole lot of fun. So yeah, that's mine.
Good one. So I did more kind of like overarching themes, which is what I typically do with these. Mm-hmm. So because you did a Lost in Translation, I'll give you one of those two. I did Drive My Car.
Okay.
Ryusuke Hamaguchi. Right. So, a renowned stage actor and director learns to cope with his wife's unexpected death when he receives an offer to direct a production of Uncle Vanya in Hiroshima, and is driven around by a young woman who's terse, right? Maybe not so open, but they develop a kind of kinship, a kind of relationship as they go through this process.
It's a good one. Since I hated her so much, I'm going to give you two artificial intelligence movies that are much, much better. And so I kind of cheated and did four, but I wanted to really insult her. So I'm going to say Electric Dreams, which I brought up last podcast, which is about a love triangle between a man, a woman, and his sentient computer. And I'm going to go Short Circuit, about Johnny Five, who's a war robot who gets electrocuted and then just desperately tries to stay alive. Falls in love with Ally Sheedy at some point, but realizes they're probably best off as just friends, and then pushes her off onto god awful Steve Guttenberg, and a lot of racist aspects into that movie as well. Yeah. But
wasn't that a plot thread in High Art as well?
Yes. She was also in love with a robot in that one.
Okay.
A robot Steve Guttenberg.
With the AI thing, I want to throw Batteries Not Included in there now because you did Short Circuit. But the real one I did was Ex Machina.
Yeah.
I mean, a pretty comparable one, but I think, again, a film that handles this idea much better. A film that, and I think this is a theme in Garland's films, there are powerful women in his movies. Alicia Vikander plays a kind of what sentient AI robot who kills the men. I mean, essentially uses them to get what she wants and becomes kind of the, the top of the food chain in that movie. Dealing with a lot of similar issues that this young lonely programmer gets connected to this robot and gets played.
Right.
Manic pixie dream girls in this film.
Not to go back and dunk our head into this stale bowl of milk, but
or creeping like, yucky.
But the lack of a sinister element in her, like, I don't understand. How is this a Spike Jonze film? Like, how, if you look at Adaptation and you look at Being John Malkovich and you look at Where the Wild Things Are, how is there there's no teeth to this film whatsoever?
No. I don't know.
I just don't get it. Like, and Soderbergh, like, so he was having trouble cutting that movie and he gave it to Soderbergh, and Soderbergh came back in less than 24 hours and gave him a 90-minute cut. And then so he had the ability to go back because it was going to be like 2 hours and 40 minutes, which next podcast we talk about how movies are getting too fucking long.
Yeah.
If John Wick is 2 hours and 49 minutes, and like,
come on, it's not long enough.
And there was something else, like there's something ridiculous, like Creed 3.
A lot
Creed
of them fucking are like 3 way
is going to be like 2 hours and 40 minutes.
And so much of it is just filler too. It's stuff you can go, look, I can just take this out and
Right.
The film is better for it. This doesn't need to be there. It's like adverbs. I can remove it from a sentence and it still works.
Right. If you need 2 hours and 40 minutes to tell your story, add 20 minutes to that story and make two fucking movies.
Well, that's the thing. Like, I like long movies.
Sure. If they need to be.
There you go.
Like, Goodfellas is a movie that I don't ever realize is almost 3 hours long.
Well, it never stops.
Right.
I mean,
and I'm not saying that, I mean, Creed 3 and John Wick 4 could be fucking masterpieces. Who the fuck knows? The jury's still out. They haven't been released, so we'll see.
We'll see next year's Oscars. Those two.
My last one, and it's a simple one. It's for Skinamarink, and I'm just going to go say, hey, if you really want bizarre, kind of surrealist movies, just go watch Eraserhead. Just watch Labor Lynch's Eraserhead.
Yeah.
I mean, it's the godfather of those films. I mean, probably not. Unchi and D'Andalou is probably the godfather of those films, but like, and go watch that.
Yeah.
That's actually pretty good. Recommended if you like. If you have never seen that, it's on YouTube. It's free. It's only 20 minutes long. It gets its point across. I mean, you know, watch Skinamarink, but I don't know.
No.
Fast forward a little bit.
Yeah. All right. My last one goes along with the themes of Lost in Translation, and that's The Lives of Others. By Florian Heckel von Donnersmarck.
That's a slept on film. It really is really good.
I cry in that movie. The Modern here in Fort Worth screened it several years ago, and I got all teary eyed again in that film in a museum theater full of three other people.
You and a bunch of other octogenarians. Like.
I know everyone was twice my age. But no, I mean, that was a movie I saw when it first came out, and then hadn't seen it again in years because I couldn't really find it. And I mean, I adore that film. I'm not sure about the ending, but other than him buying the book, I mean, I love that movie.
Yeah, it's really good. It's really good.
So go watch Lives of Others. He hasn't made a decent film since. Sorry.
Sometimes you don't have one good shot. Right?
Look, Florian, if you're listening, I still have faith in you. And just, you know, the other ones just didn't quite work out, right? This is what happens when you tie your horse to Johnny Depp.
Yeah.
And Angelina Jolie.
Right. Yeah.
try to make something for the American market.
It's like Rich Kelly for me. That he did Donnie Darko, and I was like, oh, this guy is going to fucking just kill it.
Yeah.
It'll be so good.
I want to add one more thing to Skinamarink, and that is that people should go watch Michael Snow's Wavelength. It's more of a piece of experimental kind of like video art. It's on YouTube as well. And I think it's like 20, 25 minutes, but it is a stationary camera in one room. And you'll see the kind of influence. You'll see Skinamarink took the sounds, right? The kind of like alien sounds from like this, or how it would sort of, you know, zoom in and focus on one spot in the room until you started to see something else in that spot. It's really worth, you know, checking out, I think, along with things from, you know, Stan Brakhage and that ilk. So, yeah. Okay, so next time we are going to look at the screenplays of Elaine May and wrap up our May Madness series. Those screenplays will be Heaven Can Wait, Primary Colors, Birdcage, and that Otto Preminger film that I can't remember. Such Good Friends.
Such Good Friends. Yeah, I was going to say someone like, I know it's not somewhere up there, someone up there likes me, but yeah, that's what I had in my head. So
we will do that. And anything
else? Have you seen all of those, or have you seen?
I have seen all of them except the Preminger.
Yeah, same.
So I guess we have our work cut out for us. And two of those are Mike Nichols films,
right?
And then Heaven Can Wait is a Warren Beatty. I think he directed it, right?
Beatty directed it,
and starred in. Because he brought her that he was paying her back with Ishtar, right? For her help on Heaven Can Wait, which she received full screenwriting credit for, and then kind of an uncredited work on Reds as well. Beware of Warren Beatty bearing gifts is what is what I would say. Anything else you want to do next episode?
I think four is probably good. Okay. Yeah, let's stick with four and let's close out May with the proper attention that she deserves and a
standing ovation.
Yeah, absolutely. And we'll circle back and kind of just bow our heads and dream of a world where there are many, many more May films. But alas, we have the four that we have, and you know what? I'll take them.
I will too. Three and a half. excellently.
Right. Three and a really good potential soundtrack for a fourth and that never right. came to fruition.
Three and some great ideas.
Yeah. I think we need to circle back and become like, we need to become like really just like, we need to dive into the lore of Ishtar. We need to really truly understand it. We need to like be champions of that film. Just that's that.
It looks like 15 episodes is a good place to stop this podcast.
Are we up to 15 already?
Yeah.
Oh, nice.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay. Well, if that's it, yeah. I mean, after that little diatribe we just had, stay tuned.
Brock and I will keep talking about how the world's going to burn here in the next. So well, we won't subject you to that.
You don't have to listen. You guys, if you're listening to this, you already know that it's all burning. But regardless, thank you all for listening.
And keep screaming.
You have been listening to Why Does the Wilhelm Scream with your hosts, Brock and Jason. If you liked today's episode, do us a favor and rate, review, and subscribe in whatever application you use to consume podcasts these days. You can reach us by visiting whydoesthewilhelmscream.com. If you're in the DFW area, we would love to see you at a Fort Worth Film Club event. You can learn more about those and find a full schedule at fortworthfilmclub.com. And you can learn about my foundation and how we are trying to foster the next generation of film lovers at realhousefoundation.org. That's REEL housefoundation.org. Till next time.